To start this master class, let us all first listen to our Dean, Dr. Laverne de la Peña, who will welcome everyone in this master class.
Thank you. Thank you, Dr. Muico. Can you hear me? Okay, thank you. So a pleasant morning to everyone, to all of you, and in the case of our guest speaker, good afternoon. I am happy to welcome everyone to this master class, and I thank the Department of Composition and Theory for inviting our esteemed expert, Professor Donald Brinegar. Our world is still in turmoil, no, especially in this part of the world, but our work towards becoming better musicians go on. As we focus on tuning up today in this masterclass with the help of our speaker, we continue to remain attuned to what is happening around us. So again, thank you very much, and please enjoy this masterclass.
Thank you, Dean. So now let's introduce our speaker. So we have Professor Donald Brinegar, is a voice masterclass clinician, but he's also our professor emeritus of music at Pasadena City College. No? So he directed the Carl Singers program at this college for 36 years. Now he's also a conductor and has he holds a degree in music education and choral music from the University of Southern California, where he was named as outstanding graduate student in the School of Music. Also a founding teacher in Claremont United Schools, and has been twice nominated as the outstanding teacher in California. So he's recognized as the artist of the year in 2016 and has served as a president and treasurer of the University of the Southern California Vocal Association. He has an extensive background as a performer, both as a soloist and a conductor. And has performed throughout the United States, Japan, Europe, Australia, New Zealand, Mexico, and Canada. Let's all welcome Professor Donald Brinegar. Don, go ahead.
Thank you so much. So good to be here. I'm going to share my screen in a minute, and I have sent to your professor PDF of the slides that I will be playing, although the attachments won't go to the websites. I will make available to you my PowerPoint program, so I hope you'll find that enjoyable. There's many approaches we could take to this topic of pitch, but certainly we could agree that when we make music, pitch is a deciding factor in how we create harmony and melodies, even influences how rhythm can unfold. And so a deeper understanding of how pitch is both perceived and produced, I think, is an important topic for us to give some time to. I'm going to go to sharing my screen here and put the PowerPoint on. And I'm, Professor Muico, if you would be willing to field questions, or people could put them in the chat room, and I'm happy to stop at any point to just make things a little bit clearer if they need be.
Okay, I will do that. Thank you. Yes.
And so thank you so much for the kind introduction from your dean. I really appreciate that. And have looked so forward to meeting with all you. So pitch is something kind of special between instrumentalists and vocalists. Because a singer can produce an infinite number of pitches, where an instrumentalist is sometimes guided by the keys they must push, or if we deal with the percussion instrument, the piano, that key cannot change its pitch in real time. And so singers often, I wouldn't say struggle is the right word, but we tend to have such an infinite number of possibilities when we sing a pitch, that having systems which help narrow us, the pitch selection is very important. Can you all see my screen here?
Yes, we can, Dante.
Great, thank you. So the outcomes for today's class, here are some of the things I would like us to accomplish in our time together. How is pitch organized in our canon of music? I'm going to teach you about air keys, which is a very quick way to teach young people the circle of fifths. Very often, if you teach a class about the circle of fifths, it can take weeks to unfold. I'm going to teach it to you in 2 minutes, promise. And how the circle of fifths work in staff notation, rather than putting it in a circle, rather put it on a staff and it'll establish a context for students to get it more quickly. A little brief history of tuning and pitch. I think sometimes we are not aware of some of the innovations of pitch over the history of music. Informing the ear, timbre and pitch. I want to talk a little bit about vowel formants, which are the way in which we understand not only language, but when a person sings or plays an instrument, we would refer to the instrument as having resonances, and we would refer to the singer as having vowel formants. This gives us the difference of whether we're hearing an ah or an a or an e or an oo. And for the instrumentalists, your resonances can include a great variety on your particular instrument, but again, somewhat limited by the specific timbre of that instrument. And then I'm going to talk a little bit about informing the ear, how just tuning, which is the tuning of nature, is informed by or informs equal temperament. And I'm going to show you how to organize pitch hierarchies graphically. And then talk a little bit about a piece of older music from the Renaissance and a piece of contemporary music from the late 1900s, 20th century. So let's get into the content of the lecture here in terms of meaningful score study. When I study a score, I study it with a pencil, sometimes a tuning fork, and my ear and my eyes. I don't sit next to a piano, I don't use any other devices, and I don't listen to the score until I've come to understand it, and then I will listen to maybe a recording after many hours of study. The importance of that, especially for you who are going to conduct, is that when we study a score and we just simply start with a meter and we start waving our hands, we somewhat create a level of meaningless gesture. So it's very important for me to understand every aspect that I can about the music before I actually perform it, conduct it, or sing it. That we want to create historically cogent performances. So understanding how pitch was used throughout history is kind of important. And that this creates for us, once we understand musical context and content, that this leads to a gestural vocabulary, not just a conducting of a pattern, but rather conducting something meaningful that reveals the musical content. This will lead to efficient rehearsals, which takes us away from ambiguity to certainty, improved ensemble techniques, that our ensemble gets better, and greater retention and motivation so that when we rehearse, we feel eager to seek out the truth of a particular score.
Don, wait, the screen share is not seen by our audience today. Jack, can you please fix the share screen? How come they cannot see it? Thanks.
Okay, I'll reboot the share. How's that?
Oh, okay. I think I found it. Okay. Okay, try to share screen again. Okay, can you guys see it now? Okay, thank you.
We're okay, good.
So now they can see the share screen. They miss out a lot.
Okay, well, let me back up and just show you the slides. And again, we'll leave a copy in the chat room of the PDF of this program so that you can all take a look back and see it. Let me reboot the show. Okay. So I just talked a little bit about what we're going to be having as outcomes, and you can look at that slide on your own. I do have a couple of references at the bottom, one of W.A. Matthew, a Northern California theorist, very important in the field of Indian music, especially ragas, but primarily known in the United States as a jazz musician. And he uses just intonation principles to inform his jazz. And then my own book on the pitch perfect theory and practice, which I'm happy to share with any of you who ask for it. I can send it to you in a PDF form. And then I talked a little bit about making sure that we have meaningful score study, which for me starts a lot with the aspect of what pitch am I suggesting my players play. As a singer, I can teach my singers to sing about 58 pitches within an octave. 58 discrete pitches, depending on context. This includes quarter tones, some micro tuning, certainly just intonation and equal temperament. So let's do air keys. And this requires you all to use your hands and practice this with me. So I want you to draw a C in the air and make it into a zero. So C has no sharps and flats. Got it? Let's draw a G with one stroke of the pen. G has one sharp. Let's draw a capital D, one, two. D has two sharps. Let's draw a capital A, one, two, three. A has three sharps. Let's draw a capital E, one, two, three, four. E has four sharps. Let's draw a Greek looking B, like in BC, one, two, three, four, five. I'll do it again, one, two, three, four, five. B has five sharps. Would you draw a lowercase f? One, two, and then the sharp, three, four, five, six. F sharp has six sharps, and draw a box C, one, two, three, and the sharp, four, five, six, seven. C sharp has seven sharps. So that's a very quick way to engage your students or to even engage yourself in memorizing the circle of fifths on the sharp side. So let's remind ourselves again, would you draw an A? One, two, three, and A has three sharps. Using the rule of complementation, the rule of complementation says any chromatic pair will have seven accidentals. So if A has three sharps, A flat will have four flats, three and four being seven. Let's draw a D, one, two. If D has two sharps, then D flat will have five flats. And this is true of all of our sequences. So C has zero, but C sharp has seven sharps, and C flat has seven flats. Rule of complementation, and a quick way to teach the circle of fifths without going on for weeks at a time trying to figure out what the circle means with all those letters and numbers and sharps and flats. And so here's a little chart just to remind you. If D has two sharps, therefore D flat major has five flats. A major has three sharps, therefore A flat major has four flats, three and four equaling seven. And E major, one, two, three, four, has four sharps, therefore E flat has three flats. Now, this is simply a mnemonic or a way of remembering. It doesn't explain the relationship of perfect fifths, but sometimes in music, we struggle with the relationship of numbers and letters, don't we? If I say A to E to a musician, they immediately say perfect fifth. But we don't think in those terms as that having a particular numerical distance. So that's one of the steps we need to kind of get over when we're teaching keys. And I have all my students memorize F, C, G, D, A, E, B, and backwards B, E, A, D, G, C, F. Those are very significant letters, far beyond those being the accidentals of the sharp side or the flat side. Those are also the order of the natural modes. F Lydian, C Ionian, G Mixolydian, D Dorian, A Aeolian, E Phrygian, and B Locrian, that they are all in a relationship of perfect fifths. And when in the 14th, 15th, and 16th centuries, they were conceiving and making music, they really thought through this linear line of a relationship of perfect fifths. And so our tuning and our way of approaching music of that era is by creating a relationship of continuing perfect fifths. For instance, if we go now to the right of B, it would be F sharp, and then C sharp, G sharp, B sharp, so on. And if we go to the left of F, it would be B flat, E flat, A flat, D flat. And again, that that chart of pitches creates a relationship of perfect fifth, and the tuning of those is fairly simple. We always tune them as perfect fifths, or we refer in the literature as third partials, because a third partial is a perfect fifth. Here's how I write it out for my students so they can see very quickly on a staff what a particular note indicates in terms of its accidentals if it were a major key representative. And we can see again this movable set of perfect fifths that you go from C to G, then D to A, then E to B, then F sharp to C sharp for the sharp side. And C to F, now we go down, C to F, B flat to E flat, A flat to D flat, G flat to C flat for the flat side. And again, seeing this and memorizing this immediately puts the student in contact with the score, which sometimes the circle of fifths just looks like a chart that we don't quite see in the music. And you all know that a key signature doesn't represent just major, it represents all the possible modes. Popular today, isn't it, to have no key signature and just use accidentals within the music to represent all the different key centers, particularly if you're moving through an atonal set. But in our classical canon, knowing the key signature is kind of a gateway to understanding how the music unfolds. So here's some pitch factoids that you might want to know. The A that we know as the beep was as low as F and as high as C sharp on the high side throughout history. So that means that when you go back and play, let's say, something by Mozart, Mozart's tuning wasn't 440. Mozart's tuning was 421.5. Therefore, Mozart's music sounded a half step below what we hear today. Same is true of Handel. So when we think of the Alleluia chorus being in D major, it's actually sonically in D flat, which turns out to be a very friendly key for singers, because most singers can kind of belt out an A flat, but once you get across A flat to A, it becomes a little bit more challenging for the voice. A equals 440 was not common use in the world until 1955. So that's kind of a late invention. We have the first references, according to several authors, of A 440 happening in the French opera houses of 1854. And so we begin to see a relationship between the way the instruments are constructed, the way resonance is created, the way pitch is organized around a particular pitch. The first common use of a pitch that was not a pipe, most pitches were given through a pipe. And of course, as you know, certainly from where you live, pipes can have a varying pitch quite a bit, particularly the hotter the day gets and the more the humidity, the more the pitch will change, won't it? And so the Handel's trumpet player and his lutenist, John Shore, invented a mechanical device called a tuning fork in 1711. So that's the first reference we have to a fixed tuning. If we think of the whole of the history of music in the world, that's fairly recent, isn't it? It's not too long ago. The first pianos tuned to equal temperament were based on formulas created by William White in Boston in England. And so we don't have equal temperament until 1917. So what that suggests to you is that if you're thinking of Brahms or Beethoven or Mozart or Debussy or even music of the world, the equal temperament is a very limited area of used for people who have fretted instruments. That could be equal temperament, but organs were not equal temperament and keyboards were not equal temperament. And so it's not until 1917. So all these earlier composers were composing in other kinds of pitch relationships. And essentially they were called mean tone and well temperaments. And there were dozens of these kinds of tunings of which a composer started to have a preference for a certain one. For instance, Bach enjoyed a tuning called Andre Werkmeister III. Andre Werkmeister being a contemporary of Bach and a composer who created a tuning system where you could tune in one tuning and then play all the keys and they would still have their characteristic color. And so D major had a more militant, heroic, royal color. E flat was kind of thought as murky and dark. And in some cases you hear composers say it was kind of an evil key. And on I could go with the various ways composers thought of pitch context. And we don't really think of that at all because our equal temperament just lays out the keys. There it is. The cool thing is equal temperament represents all the mean tone, all the well temperaments, but you're kind of obligated to go back and hear those temperaments in real time. And I'll talk about that a little bit more later. Mozart's A was 422.5. I think I said 421, 422.5, and Purcell about 412. In your own country, you have lots of instruments with various tuning possibilities, generally done on a perfect fifth, right? But you could also think of it in reverse order as perfect fourth. So on several of your instruments, you tune from the top string down to the bottom string. There are 500 plus tuning systems in use today around the world and about 2,500 plus scales. So this opens our eyes to the possibility that our ear is not hearing all the possibilities. Exciting for you who are composers because you can involve yourself in music of other traditions and you can borrow that aesthetic sensibility of the way pitches are organized. So some people refer to that as just tuning or micro tuning. There are also equal temperaments that are not 12 tone. There are equal temperaments that are 9 tone or 10 tone or 15 or 19 tone is very popular among some folks. And you could easily find this music on the internet. So I'm going to play a little example here and I'd like some feedback that you can hear it. I'm going to play two examples, an example A and example B, and each one is trying to represent an octave. And I wonder if you can tell me which one you prefer. Is the A clear to an octave or is the B clear to the octave? Now I'm going to tell you, neither one plays the octave like you and I hear it, but one seems to be closer than the other. Let's see what the possibilities are here. That's A. And that's B. Let's do it again. So here's A. So there are two ways to listen to this. The A version, you notice that the pitches are given separately and then together. And when we hear them separately, they seem to be pretty close to an octave, but when they're played together, they seem to be quite dissonant in quality. And B, when we separate them, that sounds like the first pitch to the next pitch is slightly sharp, but when they're played together, they sound more in tune. So let me play that one more time and see if you can hear the first one is sounding as an octave but dissonant, and the next one as a stretched octave but sounding more consonant. So you hear that sounds a little bit more like an octave, doesn't it? And then it continues. Now it's played together. And it clashes, doesn't it? And here's the next one. See how stretched that feels? And then together, though, sounds pretty good. So what's going on here? It's going to turn out that that we prefer tunings that we know. So whatever you grow up with, there's evidence in history of people with perfect pitch who grew up with keyboards that were pretty out of tune. So their brain gets a little bit estranged when they hear something that we call in tune, but they're used to the out of tune. The fact is, the first one is a true octave, but because the timbres are mismatched, it sounds out of tune. This is another way of saying that we prefer sounds in terms of consonants that match in timbre, not necessarily pitch. And this will explain why those of you who've ever sung in a choir where the choir is singing beautifully and you all feel like you're in agreement, but when the pitch reference comes back in, you've drifted down by a half step. That's because you've appreciated the timbre, but you haven't organized your hearing around the accurate pitch distance. So we tend to prefer monitoring pitch by timbre rather than actual pitch frequency. So this is something conductors need to work on. We need to hear both. This next example involves us listening to singers, and there's a lot of claims that singers can't sing in just intonation. Having practiced just intonation now for 40 years, I can claim that yes, we can come pretty doggone close to approximating good just intonation, which is basically saying intonation based on nature and the overtones. All the other tunings, which we would call irrational tunings, overtone singing is rational tuning, and all other temperaments, like equal temperament, are mathematical adjustments of the scale to match a certain instrument. For instance, if you just tune a piano, it sounds not too complementary. There's a lot of pitches sound like they clang, but if you tune it in equal temperament, it sounds marvelous. So here's an example of a choir singing, Thomas Tallis. This happens to be the Hillier Ensemble. And let's listen to their singing. So you hear in groups that just tune early music, you hear this very present kind of buzz in the sound, where the perfectus and perfect forest are tuned so that they have no beats in them, but they have kind of a buzz because of the reinforcement of the overtones. Now let's listen to this keyboard representation of that performance. And I'm going to play two different ones. One is in equal temperament and one is in just intonation. See which one better matches the singers. If you'll listen to this many times, you'll begin to understand that the singers are approximating overtonal intervals, just intonation, and especially tuning intervals by perfect fifths. And the equal temperament creates a very effective sound, but we tend to start losing colors and we start losing the effectiveness of that buzz, which composers in the day really employed. So Gary Garrett on his website does a representation of what we just saw by using a map. And so I want you to listen to the two different versions. Now, it's going to be true that in just singing or just intonation playing, one has to practice some principles behind it, and they're all timbre specific. That is to say that if you choose a particular timbre, but play in a particular tuning, it may sound wildly out of tune. But if you play with a certain timbre within a certain pitch context or tuning, it'll sound very beautiful and very complementary. Listen how this works in lattice representation. Now, to our contemporary ears, that sounds very reasonable. It sounds like it's familiar, might be even comfortable. But listen to this now in just intonation, remembering now.
Aloha and welcome to my backyard in Waimea on the Big Island.
I have no idea what that is.
I'm Angelisa.
Oh, wait a second.
This is Gary, and we are the Harmony People. Don't you love our tiny desk? We work out here all the time.
Let me reboot here. Sorry about that. I forgot that it would go on by itself. But Hawaiian music is beautiful. Okay, so you heard Gary Garrett's version. That happened to be played, by the way, on a piano that belongs to Matthew, the theorist that I referred to earlier. Now the piano has been retuned to just intonation, or actually this is another piano that Matthew owns that is tuned in JI, and listen to how this sounds. So you might suggest that the piano tuned to equal temperament has a more consistent or pleasing sound, but just intonation has its fans too, where you get different colors. Generally speaking, just intonation will sound on the thirds, sixths, and sevenths a little flat to the contemporary ear. But once you get used to hearing just intonation, you see other color possibilities, but especially for singers, you create more resonance. That way. And this is how we measure resonances in singers. They're called vowel formants. So you could see here, this is E, this is oo, this is ah, and you could see the different vibrations that are created by going through the vowel triangle. So in earlier music, this particular approach was used of creating vowel formants to employ tetrachords, which created our modes. Any mode was combination of two tetrachords. Our modes are Lydian, Ionian, Mixolydian, Dorian, Aeolian, Phrygian, and Locrian. Remember, this was F white note, C white note, G white note, D white note, A white note, E white note, and B white note. No accidentals being used, but if I sing Do, Re, Mi, Fa, Sol, La, Ti, Do, and you hold Do, Do, while I sing that, you'll feel that the Do changes color from bright to dark as I go from Lydian to Phrygian. So if you would all hold Do in your own room, Do, and I'm going to sing Do, Re, Mi, Fi, Sol, La, Ti, Do, Do, Re, Mi, Fa, Sol, La, Ti, Do, Do, Re, Mi, Fa, Sol, La, Te, Do, Do, Re, Mi, Fa, Sol, La, Te, Do, Do, Re, Mi, Fa, Sol, La, Te, Do, Do, Ra, Mi, Fa, Sol, La, Te, Do. You might feel your Do getting darker, which is exactly what the earlier composers were trying to achieve, was a color shift by shifting modes. So some people have equated this to changing moods, but it really had more with color and the way the instruments or the singers would change their color depending on what mode. This is another way of saying that if I want to sing Lydian and I want to sing it and make it sound in tune, I have to sing with a brighter tone. And if I want to sing Dorian, I have to sing with a slightly darker tone, and Phrygian, very dark tone. So we have to match our timbre to our pitch set. And so this is an early look at how modes work. For instance, you can look at vowels in terms of their complexity. In other words, you see all these vibrations here, but notice in the E is split. There's this kind of non-resonant area. And that's because E is not just E, it's also OO. So notice the OO that the E and the OO share these two vowel formants. But as we get up higher, the OO gets weaker, but the E gets stronger. So here's a way that you could tell. Sorry, it's sunsetting. It's here and it's coming through my curtain. So if I sing E, E, but just cover my mouth, E, OO, I'm left with the fundamental of E. In other words, OO is part of E. And OO creates E. So OO is the fundamental. So as you sing higher, we tend to add more length and more OO because that creates more fundamental. Same is true of A. A will become O. But here's the key concept. If you've ever been in a group where the basses tend to sound a little flat, but they'd swear they're on the right pitch, it's because their vocal tract is misshapen, and although they're getting an ah vowel, they're getting a flat one, a little bit like a French horn when they plug the French horn and now modulates down a half step. So a poorly sung ah becomes ah, ah, it modulates, but if I change my vocal tract length, then the ah will stay stable and in tune. It's a good way to test whether you're singing good pure vowels. So again, the modes, Do, Re, Mi, Fi, Sol, La, Ti, Do, has to be sung with a brighter tone, and Do, Ra, Mi, Fa, Sol, La, Te, Do, has to be sung with a darker tone because it is at the other spectrum. So there's a way that I can chart out these notes and create two different tuning systems that we can use today in just intonation. The one here at the bottom is called three limit, and it's the one that was used all the way up until the time of Bach. Essentially, you're just tuning perfect fifths the whole time. So here are our notes in perfect fifth order. Again, F, C, G, D, A, E, B, which I told you earlier would be good to memorize because they are important to the understanding of modes and the relationship of perfect fifths and the order of the accidentals. And so if I'm singing a piece in G and all of a sudden I see a C sharp, I begin to realize that I've either modulated or I've moved to a different mode. If you ever do the music of Vaughan Williams, he's very fond of changing modes. So the key signature, so the key tone doesn't change, but the key signature does. And so you can track that by mapping the accidentals in the piece. So when we string the notes along that line at the bottom, this one right here at the bottom, when we string those notes together, we've created what is called a three limit or third partial tuning. All perfect fifths. So if I sing a scale based on all perfect fifths, it sounds like this. Do, re, mi, fa, sol, la, ti, do. It'll sound a little bit sharp or a little bit bright. Da, pa, da, pa, da, pa, pa, pa. Our piano scale is da, pa, 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 all equal. And our just fifth limit, where now we have fifth partials along with third partials, is ba, da, ba, da, ba, da, ba, da. So we hear how the flat, the third, sixth, and seventh sound. But actually, they're very in tune to resonance and lack beats, but actually have a kind of a buzzy quality when they're created like that. So this is called lattice diagramming. I lattice diagram all my pieces as well as do Roman numeral analysis. Roman numerals reveal certain relationships that are important to understand, and lattice tells me that at any one time the notes are put in this specific order. So to give you a taste of that, let's sing a scale. I can't hear you all sing it, but I'm going to assume you're doing it beautifully. And you can also, if you want, later on, play this on your own instrument. So if I sing at the beginning of this, I would go do, re, mi, fa, sol, la, sol. And then if I were singing in C, I'd use the red lettered syllables. Sol, la, ti, do, re, mi, re. And that would be how we look at it from this century. However, if I look at it from the point of 16th century polyphony, they would have had a mutation because they did not sing scales as we sing them. Do, re, mi, fa, sol, la, ti, do, because they didn't use ti, do. They used do, re, mi, fa, sol, la. That was the limit. Now that has to change to do, re, mi, fa, sol, la, sol. And that mutation, by the way, gives a lift to the music. And when you put all the mutations in a Renaissance motet, it rarely will go out of tune because these are changing hexachords. We would think of them contemporarily as modulations. But in fact, they are just making sure that the mi and the fa, the half step, are always generating a hexachord name. So for instance, C hexachord versus G hexachord. So I use as the example here, do, re, mi, fa, sol, la, sol, do, re, mi, fa, sol, la, sol. Notice how different the quality of that G hexachord is versus do, re, mi, fa, sol, la, sol, sol, la, ti, do, re, mi, re. Just doesn't sound the same. And generally speaking, in a Palestrina motet, there's never less than three hexachords. You can say modulation if you want. Three hexachords and often as many as six, depending on the theology of the piece. And the hexachords were determinant of the theology. The higher the hexachord from the keynote, let's say we have a signature here of C, don't we? But I wouldn't call it the key of C. I would call this as the root or the principal hexachord as C. And then the dominant above that would be G. And there would usually be another hexachord, D, which would involve for the first time the F sharp. And usually a hexachord based on the subdominant would be on F. So you're generally going to see four hexachords involving the key signature is related to one hexachord and then the additional of accidentals depending on how far they go up. So I give you this example of E flat. Do, re, mi, fa, sol, la, sol. But now we go do, re, mi, fa. Notice mi, fa is do, re, mi, fa, sol, la, sol. So we would have a changing accidental. It should be a D natural, by the way. Hexachord mutations, so very, very important. So here's Sicut Cervus, which many of you know. Let's see if I have the full, yeah, there's the full score. So here's Sicut Cervus, and you see four flats, and your brain says, well, let's see, draw an A, one, two, three, A has three sharps, so therefore A flat must have four flats, and the first note's an A flat, so therefore we're an A flat. But in fact, Palestrina very often does not start in the key signature first tone. He'll start in a hexachord that is a fifth above that. So in other words, this starts on fa, not do. And so what I want you to hear is the difference between what it sounds like when it's done in contemporary equal temper tuning versus what it would sound like if it were in Renaissance tuning. So if I think of this as being in the key of A flat, my first note is A flat, so I'm going to call that do. Do, do, re, do, so, do, re, mi, mi, fa, mi, re, mi, so, fa, mi, re, mi. But instead of, I think of this as fa. Now, it's interesting, historically, the chanting tone for early chant was fa. Not do, but fa. And they would chant fa 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 re fa 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 re fa 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 so fa re do. So we have notes that are essentially in perfect fifths being lined out. Well, this is not new to the ears of Palestrina. He knew that a lot of chant began on fa, and so therefore he includes this in his own Sicut Cervus, and starts on fa. Fa, fa, so, fa. Here's a mutation. Do, then back to do. Do, re, mi, mi, fa, mi, re, mi, so, fa, mi, re, mi. So, fa, mi, re, do, mutation, do, mi, fa. And very often that mutation happens on a longer note, or it happens on a slurred note over the bar line. Very, very common in Palestrina to see that. So I was taught growing up that when we saw longer notes, we should crescendo, but in fact, what we do is mutate and change color. So if I crescendo it, so fa mi, re, do, mi, fa, versus color change, so fa mi, re, do, mi, fa. I get a whole different affect by color changing, and the dynamics stay beautiful and in control and cathedral-like rather than expressing it in a way that overblows the cathedral. So here we see all the parts lined out, noticing that the tenor starts on fa, but look at the alto note. The alto starts on fa, but the fa now has become E flat because they are in a B flat hexachord. So for another lecture, I can explain hexachord mutations and how to determine where they are. But just remember this, wherever you see the half step, that's mi fa. And sometimes, and based on the notion of the gamut, we don't exceed the range of a particular hexachord unless we mutate. So for instance, if I start on A flat and go A flat, B flat, C, D flat, E flat, F, that's the limit. F, E flat, D flat, C, B flat, A flat, that's my hexachord limit. If I go below it, A flat, then I go to G, F, E flat, I have to have a mutation, because we don't ever exceed the gamma oot. So therefore, if I start on E flat hexachord, fa, fa, so, fa, let's look at the tenors. Si, cu, cer, bus. Very clearly, this we're using points of imitation here as our compositional style, and that the soprano and the tenor move to the A flat hexachord at the same time. Not together, but they do it in terms of if you count the notes. But here's the alto coming in. You get the idea that we now have a mutation in within two parts. And it's not unlike Palestrina to use three different hexachords at the same time when he is expressing the theology of the Trinity. And this is written in, just like Bach wrote in themes and ideas and motives that were representational of a certain spiritual or theological concept. This was not new. This is something that, based on Vatican II in, 1545, Palestrina has adopted this kind of conservative style of lining out the notes in a way that are clear to the text without adding a lot of extra musical material. And yet he speaks to the theology by using this very clever hexachord mutation to give the music kind of a heightened quality and heightened spiritual understanding. In contemporary music, we would use not three limit tuning like we did in the Palestrina, we use five limit. And here you see a graph of the famous O Magnum Mysterium of Morten Lauritsen, where he uses the stacking of notes, not just based on perfect fifths, but on major thirds. We could say this another way. You can reduce any piece of music to just the intervals of a perfect fifth or a major third. So for instance, C major would be C to G perfect fifth and C to E major third. What if it was a minor? It'd be C to G, but E flat to G would be the major third, but it's a downward major third. So this is kind of the yin and the yang of the Western canon, that we have overtonal notes and we have undertonal notes. And there is a fundamental and five overtones and six undertones. So it's always this conversation between the overtonal world and the undertonal world. And here's a perfect example in Morten Lauritsen's O Magnum Mysterium. Here he creates his signature chord, and you see that I've referenced it this way as D followed by a perfect fifth A followed by E, and then a fifth partial, which we call a major third. And this, I put it in yellow because this chord has kind of a bright, sunny-like atmosphere. Let's look at this next chord, which looks very similar, but because of the addition of the G, now has a slightly darker or more compassionate quality. This is our major chord here. Here's another version of the major with an added nine, major with an added nine, and that quality. And so this is my group singing it pretty much in just intonation, but you'll hear how the tuning is creates space. When I was growing up, we would teach dee, 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 and this would be very dissonant. We tried to keep that second kind of beating and alive. Here, you're going to sound those notes sound very smooth and very legato. This is the Donald Bringer singer singing it in honor of Morten Lauritsen's 75th birthday 4 years ago. Where did you go? There you go. Okay, that'll give you an idea, and because I'll be sharing the PowerPoint with you, you can go back and listen to the whole thing, or you can go on to YouTube and just put my name in and you'll see all the recordings. I've got 70 or 80 recordings on YouTube that you can take a look at. So that's the contemporary use of just intonation. It sounds somewhat familiar, but you hear the chords have a different kind of quality because we're employing perfect fifth and major third tunings, which are born of the overtone system. I want to just move on to one other subject here briefly and talk to you about those who can't match pitch. We tend to refer to people who can't match pitch as people that have tone deafness or can't hear well. And in fact, it's not that they don't hear well, it's that they can't discriminate the fundamental out from all the overtones that they hear. I refer to these folks as having rainbow ears because their ears actually hear lots of sounds, but they can't pick out the one fundamental. And the way we do that is we have to reduce all the overtones. So if you ever want to get someone to match pitch, eliminate the overtones. I first learned this when I stepped into my first day of teaching elementary school. And I walked into a classroom of students who were singing a song to greet me. And it's a song I knew. And so after they finished, I said, "That was so beautiful. Can I join you?" And when I joined them with my adult voice, all of a sudden I could hear students missing pitches and starting to search and look for me. And I realized that I needed to reduce the overtones in my voice so as not to confuse them. So I went to what I called my Mickey Mouse voice. And let's use a folk song. Mary had a little lamb. And if I do this, Mary had a little lamb, the non-matchers of pitch would think I went higher. And if I did this, the non-matchers of pitch would think I went lower. So you and I will hear that as the same pitch with a different timbre. They don't make that shift. So therefore, if you want to get someone to match pitch, use your falsetto, use a flute, use an ocarina, use a recorder, but don't use an instrument rich in overtones. And certainly don't use the piano because the inharmonicity of the piano totally confuses their ear. So I'll have them go, Mary had a little lamb. And I say, match my mouth. I said, do you hear a voice in your head? And they'll often say, no. I said, well, let's do it again. Let me do it again for you. You hear a voice in your head now? And they'll someone go, yeah, kind of. I said, well, use enough breath to go up high. Mary had a little lamb and match me there. And generally within 30 seconds or so, they'll be matching. And then I say, follow my voice. And generally speaking, you'll hear this big gulf. They'll clunk between because their chords are literally frozen in where the notes that we're supposed to perform are. And the way to get them to do that is start with your tune very low, but very, very breathy. The same technique we use with people who stutter to get them to stop stuttering is to use breath before they phonate. So, Mary had a little lamb. Mary had a little lamb. Mary had a little lamb in that manner. So that the breathiness takes out enough of the overtone that they can hear the fundamental pitch. And usually within 5 to 10 minutes, I'll have each student matching pitch. All the guitarists, all the pianists at my college would come see me the first week of school if they couldn't match pitch so that they could be successful in their musicianship classes. Otherwise, they were, when everybody sang, there was such confusion in their ears. So remember, overtone, people who don't match pitch are simply challenged by the fact that they hear lots of timbre and lots of sound. They can't discriminate the fundamental. And so we need to stop calling them tone deaf. In fact, they're tone rich, and help them and facilitate them to learn where the fundamental is. And this doesn't take a lot of time, but it takes some diligence. And the older the person is, the more you have to retrain the muscles and the mind to do it. So I wanted to leave enough time for some questions and some opportunity to have you interact with me personally. How are we doing with all this? Is it good?
Okay, so everyone, you can either put in your question in the chat box, or you can just do a raise hand. We can call you. You can ask question, here you know, with your video on or mute, rather unmute yourself and ask a question. Let's open the the floor now to ask questions, no? Okay, anyone would like to start? Or you can do a raise hand thing and I'll call you.
Totally confused everybody.
I also emailed all the faculty of the YouTube link, so you can get the YouTube link from your teachers. Just email them. Just ask them. Okay. Okay. Anyone who would like to raise a question, I can ask now. We still have a minute, you know, a few minutes. Or those who would like to have maybe a personal clinicking. Is it okay, Don? Like, if we get like a one or two clinicking with in a breakout room after this, if they're available. Dawn can actually do clinicking with if you have problems with pitch or singing.
So absolutely.
Oh, he's happy willing to do a one-on-one. Let us know. We can do a breakout room for those who don't have classes after this.
Happy to help.
Okay, there's a question here from Dr. Merfield. Is the concept of mutation the same as the movable door?
Yes, it is. It's exactly the same. And movable do recognizes that there is a tonic which creates a relationship between all the other notes. It's kind of interesting that if you look at the Kirwan symbols, notice that the do looks like a C. You see that? And let's look at sol. That's the open hand with the thumb down. And mi in between. So here's your do. Here's your third partial. Here's your fifth partial, but look at how the other notes come in. Here's re. Notice that that looks like sol turned up. So re is a perfect fifth of sol. So it's do, sol, re, do, sol, re in order, mi in between. Let's look at fa. Fa is not the note below sol, but it's the perfect fifth below do. So this represents the note being a reciprocal, that is an undertone, not an overtone. There is no F in the overtone series of C, but it is a perfect fifth below do and in fact creates do. So remember I told you the reciting tone was fa? The tuning of any particular key can start with fa because it creates all the other notes as overtones or the Lydian scale. Maybe some of you can see that as you look at it now. And then la, look at la, what's it look like? Well, it's the undertone of mi. So here's mi and here's la, right? So A is a perfect fifth below E as F is a perfect fifth below G. And then T is kind of interesting because now we've got all of the notes of G. So if I ever sing a da, ba, 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 a major seven, it doesn't sound like it's restless. It sounds very settled, which is why a lot of jazz chords. But that's because B in C is made up of do and mi and sol. All those notes make up B, and we might call that a super consonance. But once we get that in tune, it's very stable. However, if I do it melodically, do, re, mi, fa, sol, la, ti. It's restless and wants to resolve to do. This is why we tend to think of melodies as being third partials and harmony as being fifth partials. So, and it's often taught in conservatories that way. So that you sing all melodies with the distance of perfect fifths and you sing all harmonies or play all harmonies as if they're made up of perfect fifths and major thirds. So yes, movable do was in fact the way that the young people moved through it, and they used the Guido hand. And the Guido hand was something that they counted on, ut, re, mi, fa, sol. And then they moved around their hand to show the three different hexachords, the one a perfect fifth above C, G, or the one a perfect fifth below C or the F.
Okay, thank you, Don. Now another question from another faculty. How do you address the solfege issues encountered by instrumentalists who play transposing instruments?
Yeah, that's a great question. This is, of course, then the advantage of fixed do, isn't it? And so solfege, which is solfeggio, which is fixed do, and movable do, which is tonic sol fa, I think should both be taught. You know, my first 3 years of university training, the first university I went to did numbers, the second one did movable do, and then the third one did fixed do. So I was pretty challenged because I already could sight read music, but the beauty of understanding solfeggio is about function. And still the oldest conservatories in the world teach solfeggio versus teaching movable do. So advantages to all of the systems in certain ways. I was a trumpet player, so I was playing a transposing instrument. So as I played my C, it sounded B flat. So I'd have to play a D to sound C. And so it's a great question. You know, some conductor scores are all transposed to C, so you see are to the same transposition level. Some maintain. I prefer to see the instruments in their native form when I'm conducting. But the practice of solfeggio is really more than anything else about function, isn't it? And I teach it this way in classes. If I go, do, re, mi, fa. Again, do, re, mi, fa. When I get to fa, my brain says it wants to continue. Sol, la, ti, do. But if I go, do, re, mi, fa, and then go, sol, la, ti, do, with the same notes, I've changed their function because I've changed their position in the tonic sol fa or in the solfeggio. And it's understanding that that brings the notes to a closure. So we tend to say dominant harmonies, sol, la, ti, do, kind of return to the center, and that do, re, mi, fa tend to open up from the center. In contemporary aesthetics, they refer to as the sensory consonants, the idea of being in the center, and sensory dissonance as being far away from the center. And that's the contraction of sensory dissonance and sensory consonants creates a certain kind of motion or movement in music. It's an interesting concept and one that's been thought about and used in music for nearly 50 years. Where in Bach's time, we would think of the analysis of music in terms of how it moves us as being more contrapuntal in nature. So sensory consonant, sensory dissonance certainly works beautifully with contemporary composers like Pärt or Whitaker or Lauritsen, because there's not a lot of counterpoint to account for. But this now accounts for how the music moves us, because we're thinking in terms of the push and pull from a center, psychological center. Does that help?
So in short, are you saying that a movable do singing can actually address the question of regarding teaching instrumentalists who play transposing instruments do better in solfeggio? Would movable do be one of the possible solutions?
Yeah, I tend to use movable do with singers, and I tend to use solfeggio with instrumentalists if I'm in a rehearsal and I need to, you know, work out some kind of interval system.
Okay, there's another question. Don.
And solfeggio, by the way, is exactly equal temperament. It doesn't account for just intonation.
All right. There's another question. How do you reconcile the movable do method with learning atonal music?
Well, I use all systems. Or another way to say it is that I look at any piece of music and say, how does it want to be understood, rather than bring an analytical system and lay it on the music. A good example is sonata allegro form. Very popular form of the classical period. no two compositions using the formula exactly the same, and no one composition demonstrating the theoretical perfect sonata allegro. So if you bring the pattern of sonata allegro and look at the music, now you're going to see the brilliance of a Mozart versus a Salieri, because Mozart used it in so many clever and deep and meaningful ways, where normal composers would be, or regular composers, those that have not become so famous, tended to do it in kind of an ordinary perfunctory way. So any analytical system we bring, and I think of tonic sol fa and solfeggio as systems of giving functional meaning to notes, has to be adapted to the music. So I could never read an atonal piece using tonic sol fa, because that's just not aesthetically what's going on. That there's no key center. There are sonic icons, and they are best understood by using D flat as Ra and C as Do, and keep those the same no matter where you go in the score.
Is there any more question among students and faculty? I mean, we've been hearing from the faculty. How about the students? Do you have a question? Okay, so you can message me privately here in the chat box. We can make a room for one or two people after this session, and we can give you a chance for a pitch clinic, okay? For the meantime, I already gave the YouTube link to your faculty, your course, your teacher, and then just ask for the YouTube link to understand this some more, to catch up, no? After we take off from here, you can those who want to do a pitch clinic, we can do it in breakout room. Don't exit yet first, okay? Those who are willing to do the pitch clinic. Okay, so on this end, Jack, can you provide the certificate of appreciation to our speaker? Okay, so Professor Donald Vinegar, yes, the University of the Philippines, yes, awards the certificate of appreciation to you for conducting a masterclass and pitch clinic among students and faculty. It's a lot to absorb, but we will be reading more of the, also watching the YouTube link. And in case there will be questions, I could forward your email to them.
So, well, this is so beautiful. Thank you. That's very nice.
Yes. Yes, I will email this to you as well.
Okay.
For your souvenir in talking to our class. And by the way, Professor Don Brinegar also has a website, no? Peach, was that again, Don?
Peachtheory.com. Pitchperfecttheory.com.
Okay.
Pitch Perfect Theory.
Yeah. Can you type it here in the chat box just so they can see it?
Let me see if I can get it up here.
Okay, while you're looking for it, I'll just read the acknowledgement. So I'm acknowledging, of course, the College of Music for allowing this masterclass, and also Department of Composition Theory, our chair, Professor Toledo. We also welcome the Department of Conducting and other departments as well. We'd like to acknowledge Jack Bautista for his technical assistance. Yay, thank you, Jack. Hubert for the design of our PubMat, and of course, the certificate. And also acknowledging Dr. Titus Levi, who actually sponsored the honorarium for our speaker today.
Oh, thank you.
Dr. Levi, he's the coach of his coach is Don for many, many years in California, vocal coach. So, and he learned a lot from Don. That's why we're having him today. So now in the chat box, you can see his website, Professor Brinegar's website, peachperfecttheory.com. Okay, so you can also look at his website. Okay, so thank you so much. The rest of you can go, and those who want to do pitch clinic, please stay. Again, I'd like to acknowledge all the theory faculty. Salamat. Thank you for all your support and in the masterclass. I hope you learned something, and we can have more questions, inquiry to the email address, I can give it to you. Just email me so I can, you can write Dawn as well.
Yeah, I'll put my email in the chat room right now.
Okay, thank you. Thank you.
And happy to hear any inquiries from all of you.
Okay. Okay, those who want to stay for a pitch clinic, you can privately message. So thank you, everyone. We will stay for those who want to stay. Thank you, all faculty and students.
Thank you so much.
Thank you. So now you can see all their thanks, Dawn, in the chat
box. I'm looking at it. It's really amazing. Yeah, thank you. It's great. Very generous. So anybody want to match pitch?
Yeah, so I'm waiting for some private messages here in case they want to stay.
Okay.
We can put them in a breakout room if they want one-on-one session.
Great.
Okay, do we have one person who wants to stay?
Okay.
There's a question of from a student that when he visited your website, it says it cannot be reached. Can you look at the website?
Yeah, when I get off, I'll check the link and make sure it's okay.
Yeah, okay.
If I need to update any information, I'll send it your way.
Okay.
I think I paid my fee for it. They can also go to the Donald Brenninger Singers, which has links to everything in my blog.
Ah, okay. You can also email it to me because some of the people already left. So I can also forward that Brenninger Singers, yeah, the choir.
I wrote sinners, not singers. That's terrible. Yeah, Donald Brenninger Singers on Facebook, and I'll add them to that, and they can read all the materials there. And then let me look up my blog post and see if I can. I'm on WordPress. My blog is Take 5 with Professor Dawn. At WordPress. And there it is there. Oh man, I can't spell on this. Take 5, it should say, I'm sorry, I missed it. Let me do it again. TAKEFIVE with Professor, oh, dang. I need a nap.